I L 0 minus minus I short circuit e to the minus t over tau. So when I write this out here, I short circuit, the bond was 93.8 milliamps. So I get 93.8. These will all be in units of milliamps, plus its original current, which is 500. So I'm going to get 500 minus 93.8 e to the minus 6400 t. So if I clean this up a little bit here, what I'm going to get here is I'm going to get this value of 93.8, and then this will be 406.2 e to the minus 6400 t. So this is the current of the inductor. Now, does this make sense? First thing here, what does positive mean? That it's decaying current. And that's what we said over here. We expect it to be decaying in current, and we expected a positive sign, and we could see that numerically, that's exactly what we have right there. So if I go and I plot this thing, what does this tell me here? So if I plot the current of the inductor here, what you're seeing here is that I'm going to get IL of t, and you can see it starts off at what current? It comes in at 500 milliamps. So I'm coming in at 500 milliamps, and then it jumps all the way down to 93.8.
What?
What's going on?
I thought you meant immediately, my bad.
Say that again?
I thought you meant immediately it jumps down to it.
Yeah, hopefully. I mean, if you did find one that jumped, I'd like to be on your coattails, because you would really change a lot of physics right there. I will be your friend, I promise you. Right? And it comes down to here, and we can see this guy jumps in at 93.8 milliamps here. And the important thing here is that there's that step. How big is that step? So the step and jump here was 406.2 milli jump step. And that's exactly what we kind of expected here. So when you look at this guy here, just to make sure, we said here in the past here that the current of the inductor cannot change instantaneously. We agreed that over here we have 500 milliamps, right? That's what IL at 0 minus was, this guy here. But now, what about on the other side? Am I getting 500? Well, look at the solution. I get 93.8 plus 406.2 e to the 0. So when you add 93.8 plus 406.2, you get 500 million. So on this side here, I get 500 milliamps. Okay? Just as we would expect it here. The current should be the same before and afterwards. But that's not what our problem is. Let's see, I think I'm right at the end here. So I'm going to head back this way. Okay? What I do not want to erase is I don't want to erase this guy right here. Actually, this is my circuit that I don't want to erase, because this is the circuit that I'm dealing with right here. So let's erase this here. Right, we really don't care about this circuit anymore. We care about this one right here. So this is the one I do not want to erase. So hold on a quick second. So we're trying to solve for this guy right here. We want this guy. Right? We want that VX value right there. Here's Steve. Did you have a question?
The 6400 you see, that's from the ohms. Does the kilo-ohms change that?
Can you say that again?
The negative 6400 feet, that's from using our ohms value?
Yeah, because note that if I use kilo-ohms, there's still a 10 to the 3 value there.
Okay.
And so I just said, let's not deal with 10 to the 3. Not, it wouldn't make sense. It's easier to just go right into the ohms value, right?
Okay. And it still works if we're using ohms.
No. Oh, yeah, absolutely. Okay. But okay. You'll be carrying this K value, okay. And it's easy to kind of screw it up.
Okay.
Well, I can only speak about me. I would screw it up. Okay, so here we go. So I think this is a really good circuit right here. There's a lot of depth into this circuit. And so what we know now is that when I look at this circuit right here, I know that this guy is a 0.1 Henry. And our job now with this circuit here is that, which is really our last step. What did I call the one? I'm just kind of making up step numbers. So I want to solve for V of X. Okay? Let's solve for V of X. So remember, when you go to solve for V of X, you have to make it relative to the inductor current. And one of the things that you see immediately here is that this resistor is in parallel to that branch. So they must have the same voltage drop. So what we're seeing here is that we're seeing that we have two parallel branches. And these two parallel branches essentially tells me here that Vx must be the voltage across the 0.4K plus the voltage of the inductor. But because that resistor is in series with the inductor, I could write this as what? As 0.4K times the current of the inductor, and then this guy, the voltage of the inductor, is the derivative of the current. Right? Just because they're in parallel. So let's write this out then. So what you're seeing here is that, remember, even though I didn't write it here, right, shame on me, I should have had milliamps here. So note that that milli is going to kill with that K right there. So what I'm going to get here then, if I look at this guy here, in the end, let me make sure I don't screw this value up here. Let's see, where do I write this at? It's got to be like this. So I'm going to get 0.4, right? So V of X is going to be 0.4 times the quantity 93.8 plus 406.2 e to the minus 6400. And then I got to take the derivative of this guy. So when I take the derivative of this guy, I'm going to get 0. And then I'm going to bring down this negative 6400. Okay? So remember, I can't forget about the L value. Right? So what I typically do here, then I'm going to write this as 110 times the quantity now. It's going to be minus 6400 times 406.2. times e to the minus 6400 t. Right? I'm putting all these values in here. And so then I get something that looks like this here. So assuming that you trust my numbers, that you should be suspicious of that right away, I'm going to get 2.6 times 10 to the 5
times e to the minus 6400 c. That's what times e x is. And of course, these units are in volts. So let's look at this thing. So I want to start to look at, what does all this crap mean? Right? You get all these numbers, and then you probably go like, OK, I did a lot of algebra. Well, what does it mean? Well, let's start looking at it. So the first thing that I do, I want to plot it. Okay? So I want to plot dx of t versus t. By the way, in my physics 4A class, I've been telling them, like, you better be a master of plotting. And they go like, you mean we still do plots after we get out of physics 4A? And I'm kind of like, oh, wait, please. I shouldn't talk that way, but I've been stressing the hell out of plotting. It's a big deal. Okay? Now, let's look at what happens. Now, remember, in the original circuit, what ends up happening? So you'll have to use your memory here. In the original circuit, that guy and that guy are not there. I have a 500 milliamp source, and that source shorts out the inductor, and then it kills out all the resistors here. Remember that? So what's the current of Vx initially, the voltage across the Vx? Zero. So what we're seeing here is that the voltage across Vx was zero. Now, let's go look at this voltage right here. Let's go look at this voltage. So what I'm looking at now is I'm looking at Vx at zero plus. Remember, I don't give a damn about zero minus. We're talking about zero plus. That's the important thing here. So when you're looking at this, look at that. Again, 37 minus, look at that, 2.6 times 10 to the 5. How big is that? 260,000 volts, right? 260,000 volts times e to the zero. So you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to ignore that. So what you're seeing here is that there's one big hell of a jump now, right? This thing is going from zero all the way down to 260,000 volts. And then what does it do? It comes in, and then it's going to decay back. So when this voltage does here, it then reaches 37.5 volts per decay, right? So what we're seeing here is that then this guy jumps all the way up to 37.5 volts. So then I see this charging process that brings it all the way up like that. Right? That is an insane curve if you look at that, right? Assuming that you trust my numbers here. Right? I wouldn't trust me, but assuming that those numbers are good here. So then, the question is, why is that happening? Why do you see that? Well, let's think about this here. The inductor had 500 milliamps going through here. Now it has how much going through it? I just erased it. It has like a 100 milliamps or something like that, right? So it went from 500 to about 100 milliamps. So what is this inductor going to do as soon as you try to go from 500 milliamps down to about 100 milliamps? It has that thing called the back EMF. How strong is the back EMF? Think about this. How much is the battery putting out? 100 volts. But look at this voltage drop. Where do you think that voltage drop is coming from? It has to be coming from the inductor, right? That guy can't do it. So it's got to be the inductor here. So how do we know about the inductor? I got to go back, and I got to calculate what is the voltage of the inductor. Okay? So let's go do that here. So now, let's calculate the voltage of the inductor. So when I look at that, we saw that VL was equal to L dILt dt. And if you calculate this equation here, what am I getting here? So L is going to be what? It's going to be 1/10. And then I take the derivative of the current. And remember, the derivative of the current is the derivative of that guy right there. Actually, dude, we got it right here. I don't have to recreate it. We got it right here. That's it. So that has to be what? Minus 1/10, then I'm going to get 6,400 times 406.2 times e to the 0 plus, right? So VL at 0 plus, right, that's when the switch is thrown. That's when it's going to change the voltage across that inductor here. You guys with me? Okay. This is the time you're supposed to nod your head, right? Okay, good. So now what we find here, if you calculate this number, I end up getting a number of, I get minus 260 volts. Right, because when I'm looking.
There's something mixed up over your units, I think, because when you're multiplying a whole memory by 406.2 milliamps,
and there's a factor of 10 to the negative.
Yeah, there you go.
Yes, there's a factor of 10 to the negative. You're absolutely right. Because I originally had that in milliamps. So when I take, I still got to include that milli in that value right here. Or I could bring these guys over by a factor of 3. Either one. But it was in units of milliamps right here. So when you calculate that, you get 206. So look what's happening here. Why is there such a huge voltage drop right here? Because you're seeing that this back EMF is dominating the circuit. Right? That back EMF is larger than that 100 volts right here. So I expect that I'm going to get this huge spike in the other direction, which is exactly what's happening right here. And that's because this is the one that's dominating the circuit. And that's why you're getting that spike like that. But, you know, as always, what has to happen? This EMF cannot continue. Right? There's nothing that's resupplying the inductor because it's passive. So what happens? This guy takes over. And over time, what does this guy do? It forces the current coming back this way more and more, and therefore the voltage across that resistor has to go up to this value right here. Look at that, dude. We didn't do very much today. So just think about it this way. One problem on your homework. What do I recommend? Maybe starting a little bit earlier, right? I've seen people in circuits start the weekend before the homework was due on Monday and not finish. Okay? So, and again.